seated. Harry Triemstra was born in Holland in 1931, and he passed away peacefully 1 week ago from today on Monday at Longfields Manor at 90 years of age. He was the devoted husband of Cecile and then of Helen. He was a loving father to 11 daughters and sons, a proud opa and grandpa and great-grandfather to a lot of grandchildren and great-grandchildren. He was a brother to 8 siblings, the oldest, and yet watched 7 of his 8 siblings pass on before him. He was an uncle to many nephews and nieces. He was a good friend. He was a faithful and one of the longest-standing members of our church community here at Calvin, instrumental in so many things that continue to be a part of our life together as a church. And most importantly, Harry was a son of his Father in heaven, and he was a brother of the Lord Jesus Christ. On behalf of this church community that Harry loved so much, I want to say welcome to you. We're glad to have you in this space with us, and a warm welcome to those of you who are joining us electronically as well. We want you to know that we're glad to have you with us. So welcome from us at Calvin, and on behalf of the family, I also want to offer a word of thanks. Thank you so much for taking the time to be here, to carry this burden together with the family. Those of you joining us electronically, your presence is important here as well, and I also want to acknowledge that there are a number of family members joining us electronically who probably would love to be here and are not able to. We want you to know that we're mindful of you, and your presence here, even if not in person, is still very important. Let's begin our time together in prayer. Gracious Father, make this a place of refuge for us. In these coming moments, turn this space into a sanctuary. For those joining us online, turn our homes into sanctuaries where we feel the power of your holy presence. And as we feel your presence, give us the freedom to grieve, to lament. Give us the freedom to reflect deeply. Give us the freedom to just simply be. The freedom to be at rest in your presence, free from fear and anxiety and expectation. Look tenderly on us and make this place a refuge. Turn this space into a sanctuary and use these coming moments to give us hope, to give us comfort, to give us joy. We pray in the precious name of Harry's Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to hear now from some beloved passages of Scripture, passages that speak of the hope and grace and forgiveness of God, but also of the power, the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. We'll start with Psalm 103. Psalm 103, I'll read just the first 14 verses. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all of his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, heals all your diseases, redeems your life from the pit, and crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses and his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins or repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. For he knows how we are made, and he remembers that we are dust. I'm going to read as well from John chapter 11. This is a story that's well known to some of us, a time when Jesus learns that his friend Lazarus is sick, and for reasons that are puzzling to the disciples and puzzling to the family of Lazarus, he chooses not to go and heal Lazarus, but he delays in going to visit the family, so that by the time he arrives, Lazarus is dead. And Lazarus' sisters, Martha and Mary, are rather mystified by Jesus. They knew he had healed others who were sick. Why didn't he come and heal their brother Lazarus? And so this is the encounter that Jesus has with those sisters. John 11, beginning at verse 17. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know. I know that he'll rise again in the resurrection on the last day." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." And then Jesus reveals that the reason he delayed was so that he could reveal that he has the power not just over sickness, but even over death. And he stood outside Lazarus' tomb and said, "Come forth." And Lazarus rose from the dead. That is the God who is with us as we gather in this space this morning. We're going to sing together some of the songs that your dad and Opa and Grandpa loved. These were songs that he chose for this occasion. And it'll be interesting, based on what you as a family know of him, to maybe think, what was it about that song? What was it about that text that maybe he especially loved? We're going to stand as we sing. Your orders of service note that Margaret is our accompanist, but I want to note that Sharon, Harry's daughter, is playing as well. Thanks to both of you for leading us in music. Let's stand and sing, "Lord Jesus, I long to be perfectly whole." be seated. We have the great gift this morning of getting to hear a little bit more about who Harry was through the eyes of his family. And so I'm going to invite Harry's granddaughter, Stephanie, to come forward first. And after that, Harry's son-in-law, Joe, will lead us as well.
Harry Triemstra, or Opa, as my sister and I would call him, was one of the kindest men I've ever known. Sorry. He was a hard worker, excellent farmer and gardener, as well as an amazing grandfather to many grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Over the past week, we have done a lot of reminiscing on the good old days, and I wanted to share a couple of things that came to mind. Whenever we would come to visit, Opa was usually at the computer or in the garden. We would go in for a big hug and ask him how he was. And his response was always with a big smile, "Well, I could be worse. I could be working for you." When I was in university, I had the pleasure to live with Oma and Opa for a few years. Opa always loved to be warm, and this became an issue in the winter, as he would crank the heat up all the way. As soon as he was at the computer, Oma or myself would lower the heat back to a normal body temperature, and the other person would stand guard to make sure that he didn't see us. In the summer months, Opa would go into his room, or into my room, sorry, where the AC was, and turn off the ice box, as he called it, on the most humid of days. Again, Oma or I would march right back in there and rightfully turn it back on and wait to see what his next move was going to be. Harry Triemstra was a beautiful, wonderful, beautiful soul, and we were lucky to call him our Opa. We will forever miss you and take comfort in the many memories, laughs, and hugs we shared with you. We also take comfort in knowing that you and Oma are now together again and watching over all of your family and your friends. Thank you.
I have the extreme honor of being able to say a few words to you regarding my father-in-law, your dad, brother, uncle, friend. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Joe. I'm the husband of Mary, the oldest of the Triemstra children, of which there are 11. Harry was born in Leeuwarden in the Netherlands on March 29, 1931, the first child of his parents, Wiebe and Marie Triemstra. He never wanted to talk much about his early years, but did say that one of his tasks was to help provide for the big family that he was a part of, especially during the years of the German occupation. He worked as a baker's apprentice, but always said to his father he wanted to be a farmer. To achieve that goal, he wanted to emigrate to Canada. His father tried desperately to dissuade him of that idea, but Harry, being just a little bit stubborn, persisted, and so his father decided, well, if Harry's going to go, we're going to see if we can all go. And that's what they did. The whole family traveled by boat for 10 days and arrived in Canada in July 1951. Once they arrived in Canada, he worked again briefly at a bakery where he met Cecile, his first wife, and they were married in 1953. Still following his dream of farming, they purchased a farm in Stittsville, where they raised pigs and laying hens, as well as a family of 8 children, 6 boys and 2 girls. They sold that farm and purchased a dairy operation in Ashton in the mid-70s. Cecile Triemstra, his first wife, passed away in 1979, and Dad met and then married his second wife, Helen, in September 1980. And the family grew to include 3 more kids overnight, Ken, Dwayne, and Sharon. Harry and Helen then made the decision to switch from dairy to beef farming and eventually sold that farm in the early 1990s and made the move to a home in Healy's Heath, a little suburb of Stittsville, and semi-retirement. In the late 1990s, they moved into the Eastern Ontario Christian Senior Citizens Cooperative, that's a mouthful, at 220 Viewmount Drive in Nepean. The Triemstra families were an integral part of immigrant families that helped establish this church, Calvin Christian Reformed Church. And Dad T may have likely have been the oldest surviving member of that founding group. He served on numerous church councils at Calvin and also played a role in establishing Ottawa Christian School back in the 60s. Harry was also very proud to have been a part of the team of individuals who worked to establish the Christian Seniors Co-op and Viewmount. He proudly lived there and served many terms as a board member. Harry and Helen's family grew to include grandchildren and great-grandchildren, and they were proud of each and every one of them. They had many cherished photos of all of them, and as Mary and I observed while selecting photos of Father T for the video tribute that I hope you've all enjoyed viewing. Now, sometimes I'm calling him Dad, sometimes Harry, Father T, it's all the same guy. Father T seemed at his best when helping others, whether it was neighbors, friends, or family. For example, one time I wanted to build a garden shed at one of the places I lived, about 20 feet by 12, and he told me, "Joe, don't buy rafters." I thought, "Well, why not? I need rafters." He said, "I'll make them." So he did build me rafters. He did it by hand. They were a perfect fit, but they're extremely heavy. No tribute would be complete without mentioning his love of flowers, not just flowers, but growing flowers from seed. He had very little use for cut flowers because, as he said, they just die in a few days and you got to chuck them out. After leaving farming, every place Harry and Helen lived at was beautifully adorned with flowers of all kinds, and all started from seed, either in their sunroom, windows, in a greenhouse, in the storage shed at Viewmount, and anybody who ever walked in that shed when Harry was there, oh my goodness, the stuff that was in there. But he'd also even start growing flowers in the apartments of people who left Viewmount for the winter. He'd borrow their apartments to start his seeds. Harry also grew bountiful gardens, and produce was always shared with other residents or anyone who visited. Mom Helen would make sure preserves and soups from this produce and share them with others as well. Even while living at Longfields Manor, Father Harry continued to grow flowers on the second floor terrace area. He'd start pestering people for seed, soil, and fertilizer in early February of each year, and grew seedlings in a small greenhouse we brought in for him. He'd get the flowers established in the greenhouse, then move them outdoors into pots and planters, using his walker as a wheelbarrow, and he'd carry the plants out on his wheelbarrow and also the watering cans. The room he was given permission to use at Longfields for starting these plants was renamed the garden room, and it's still called that to this day. Helen moved into Longfields Manor in early 2017, and Dad joined her a few months later. After Helen passed away in September of 2017, Dad continued to adjust to his new apartment, as he called it. While a resident at Longfields, Harry was called the Blue Man because he loved to wear blue shirts to match those sparkly blue eyes of his. With his big, mischievous smile and hearty laugh, he'd flirt with all the female staff. During his stay at Longfields, Harry was able to achieve his first ever graduation ceremony, something he didn't achieve while in Holland because they had to leave school quite early. He did this by completing various self-interest courses. When residents accomplished all that went with a course, there was a graduation ceremony complete with the cap and gown. In the photos taken at his grad, he is beaming from ear to ear. He was so proud. Father Harry continued participating in the courses for as long as his mind was able, and he really enjoyed learning so much. Music, and especially organ music, was a very calming part of Harry's daily life. When coming in to visit Dad, we'd often hear the music long before we'd seen his room or him. Staff would often comment, "That music is beautiful, but it's just a bit on the loud side," and they'd go and turn it down. Declining health and COVID isolation took their toll. Harry's memory deteriorated, his confusion due to dementia increased, and he required assistance with most daily tasks. A few weeks ago, while visiting Dad, we read the Bible with him, as we had many times before, and asked him, "Do you believe that Jesus is your Redeemer, Dad?" And he instantly said, "100%. Around the same time, he kept saying, "I want to go home." And we'd gently reassure him that, "Yeah, you are home, Dad." And he'd shake his head and say, "No, I want to go home." Now we know he was speaking about his home in heaven. On yet another occasion, he mentioned to Mary, "I should have told my kids that I loved them a whole lot more." He had difficulty expressing his affection verbally, but rest assured, as we witnessed tears running down his face during that conversation, that he did love each and every one of you very much. Father Harry lived to be 90 years of age, a good, long life. Maybe not always an easy life, but I know he would say it was a good life nonetheless. His earthly journey is now completed. He is at rest in heaven with a clear mind and no more physical pain. One last note. Father Harry loved his coffee. Those who visited him regularly knew to always bring coffee. He would see visitors coming and ask, "Did you bring me coffee? Is that one for me?" He would then take a sip and say, "Herrlich," which means delicious. So if you'd like to honor Father T, toast him with a cup of coffee. But if you're not a coffee drinker, he wouldn't mind if you toasted him with rum and coke either. Father, brother, grandfather, Opa, great-grandpa, brother-in-law, and friend, rest easy. And I won't say goodbye, but I'll say till we meet again.
Really well said, Stephanie, and really well said, Joe. Thank you so much for the time you put into that, for the heart you put into that. That was a good gift to us. Thank you. Let's sing again another song that your dad, Grandpa Opa, chose for us to sing today. We'll stand as we sing, "Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross." Be seated. Such a gift that you as a family were able to ask Dad the questions. What do you want for today? And to know what songs he wanted to sing and to know what text he wanted us to reflect on. So the text that we're going to read now and think about now is the one that your dad and Opa and Grandpa chose for us for this moment. And it's from Job chapter 19. I'll read a little bit of the context around it. The focus is verse 25, but I'll begin reading at verse 23. "Oh, that my words were written down. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book. Oh, that with an iron pen and with lead they were engraved on a rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, then in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see on my side. And my eyes shall behold and not another. My heart faints within me. I know that my Redeemer lives. Job 19, verse 25. Having met your dad, Opa, Grandpa, a little over 6 years ago, I'm told that the Harry Triemstra I knew was maybe a little more mellow, subdued version of the man that some of you knew from years before. By the time I met him, he was no longer a young dad trying to make his way in a land to which he had immigrated. He was no longer a widower or a newly married husband with an expanding family. No longer was he trying to run a farm. No longer was he trying to make enough money to put bread on the table and also to help support the church and the school and other community endeavors. His days of running off to council meetings and whatever other boards he served on, those days were long over by the time I met your dad and grandpa and opa. So I didn't meet the man who was characterized by incessant busyness, maybe busyness sometimes to the point of overworking. I didn't meet the man who was characterized by a firm authority and high expectations, authority and expectations that he admitted were maybe sometimes too firm or too high. The man that I knew was of a much gentler character, a man of great wisdom and kindness. The man I knew was a man who made a ministry of sharing the produce of his garden, and as we already heard, made a ministry of brightening the lives of those around him through his very carefully cultivated flowers. The man I knew melted his way into the hearts of the staff at Longfields Manor with his charm, his warmth, his quickness to smile rather than to complain. The man that I knew often had a word of wisdom and encouragement for his young pastor. The man I knew was a kind of man who probably would have loved an opportunity to sit down with a younger version of himself and offer some perspective. Don't be too hard on the kids, he might say to himself. And as Joe alluded to already, he'd probably say to his younger self, remember to tell them what you're actually feeling inside. Remember to tell them how much you love them. Your dad, Grandpa, Opa, he knew what it meant to suffer. He was already about 8 or 9 years old when the war broke out. He would be 14, 15 by the time it was over. There was the challenges of immigrating to a land where he hardly knew the language, where he could take almost nothing with him and start totally from scratch. There was the loss of his wife, Cecile, with many of the kids still living at home, the loss of his second wife, Helen, just weeks after he had moved into Longfields Manor in order to be with her. And life was kind of dull and kind of tasteless after Helen died for your dad and your opa and your grandpa. Things didn't have the same sparkle anymore after that. And then, of course, there was the succession of deaths in his family, the brothers, the sister, and finally to finish his life in a pandemic, to finish his life being for long periods of time cut off from that which was his greatest joy, the visits of those he loved. You as a family know there were a lot of hard days in your dad's life, your opa, grandpa's life. So it's really not that surprising that the text that he would choose for us to think about on this occasion is from the book of Job, because the book of Job is a book about suffering, so much so that Job's name is just sort of inextricably linked with suffering. He was a man who suffered tremendously. He was at one time rich, had a big family, and in just a matter of days, he lost his herds, his flocks, his servants. Worst of all, he lost his children. And then to add insult to injury, he lost his health. He was afflicted with really painful sores from the bottoms of his feet all the way to the top of his head. And that's why earlier on in chapter 19, you can find Job saying things like this: God has closed his net around me. God has set darkness on my path. God has uprooted my hope like a tree. He's made himself my adversary, my enemy. Those are sharp things to say about God, but that's the level of suffering that he went through. And then just when you think things are as bad as they can get for Job, then his friends show up and they make it even worse. Because his friends make an honest mistake, but a really painful and ugly mistake. His friends assume that there's a direct correlation between the amount of suffering in Job's life and the amount of sin in Job's life. Job's condition must be a result of the fact that he has offended God in some way. Now, we the readers know that that's not the case at all. That Job was a very righteous and upstanding man. That God wasn't mad at him at all. That, in fact, God is allowing this testing not as a form of punishment. But Job's friends don't understand that. And so in their attempt to offer godly counsel, they actually heap him with abuse, insisting, "You're the one who's to blame for your suffering. You're hiding something." And that's why in chapter 19, Job not only cries out against God, he cries out against his friends. "Have pity on me, you my friends. Why do you, like God, pursue me?" Well, it's in the midst of all of this horrible suffering and all of this horrible lament that Job utters the words that your dad, Grandpa, Opa chose for us to think about in these moments. "For I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, then in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see on my side." When you read these verses in the context of the book, in fact, when you read them just in the context of chapter 19, they almost feel like they don't belong. How is it that Job goes from this horrible lament to these incredible words of hope? They feel almost like a rose in the middle of a garden of weeds, or like a stream in the middle of the desert. All of this talk of anguish and suffering and agony, and suddenly out of nowhere, it's as if Job says, "Nope, I have a Redeemer. He's going to make things all right again." And maybe that's part of why your dad and your grandpa and your opa chose this passage for this moment. Because what Job is talking about is not pie-in-the-sky kind of hope. It's not life is all sunshine and rainbows kind of hope. This is hope in the midst of circumstances that feel like they cannot get any worse or any more painful. And your dad and grandpa and opa had enough life experience to know that that's the only kind of hope that really matters. The only kind of hope that matters is the kind of hope that can last even in the face of the hardest things that this life can throw at us. That's Job chapter 19 kind of hope. So who's this Redeemer of whom Job is speaking? Well, who is it that he expects to come and defend him in the midst of all of this suffering and all of this slander? And surprisingly, maybe even a bit confusingly, the Redeemer that Job is expecting is God himself. How does that work? How can Job go from saying, in this very same chapter, "God has uprooted my hope, God has become my enemy, and yet God is my Redeemer. God's the one who's going to make it all right again." Well, I think Job is doing something that your dad and grandpa and opa probably had to do at various times in his life, something that all of us who are Christians have to do at various times in our lives, maybe especially at funerals. He is clinging to the goodness of God, even though his circumstances are screaming at him that that is not the case. His circumstances are telling him that God is angry at him, that God doesn't care about him, that God is against him, that life is just cruel and it's cynical, and God does not care one little bit. That's what his circumstances are telling him. But somewhere deep down inside, Job knows better. And it's almost an act of willpower on Job's part to say, "No, that's not who God is." You can almost picture Job uttering these words with his fists and his jaw clenched. "Even though it feels like God hates me, I know better. God isn't out to get me. God does care about me. I know that my Redeemer lives. I know that eventually he's going to come to my defense. It's hard to know exactly what Job was expecting God to do. Maybe Job didn't even know what he was expecting God to do. Maybe Job just knew that God is too kind and he's too merciful and he's too good to just leave Job in this awful mess. Whatever Job was expecting, we certainly know that he did not understand the depths that God was going to go to in order to be his Redeemer. Job could not have understood that the Redeemer of whom he was speaking was the Lord Jesus Christ, who came from heaven's highest glory into earth's deepest darkness and mess and pain and suffering. Job didn't understand that God was actually literally going to stand upon this earth in the person of Jesus Christ and endure suffering that not even Job could fathom. Suffering that we've already sung about in the cross. And not just to suffer and die, but to be raised to life again, to burst out of his tomb again, to live forever, so that all of us who have ever suffered since the days of Job can say with him, I know that my Redeemer is alive. And that's how we know that God is on our side. We look at Jesus Christ. We look at our Redeemer. We see what he was willing to do and to suffer for us. And because he now lives and because he now reigns forever in glory, we know things will eventually be put right again. Every tear will eventually be wiped away. Now that doesn't make the pain of today go away. It didn't for Job. It won't for us. I know that your dad and your Opa, Grandpa didn't pick this text expecting that we would read it and think about it and go, oh, well, then I guess death is no big deal after all. No, it is a big deal. And it hurts, as do so many other things in this life. But I think what your dad and Opa and Grandpa does want us to know is that God is yet on our side in Jesus Christ. And because our Redeemer lives, this moment, this pain, these tears are not the end of the story. And so it might be for us the way that it was for Job, the way that it no doubt was for Dad, Grandpa, Opa at various times in his life. It might be that we have to say these words through clenched fists and tear-stained teeth, just trying as best we can to hold on to the hope that our Redeemer lives. But we have this assurance that as weak as our grip may be on these things, he will never let go of us. And one day he will wipe every tear away. Dad knew, Opa knew, Grandpa knew. He wanted us to know as well that Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, is alive, and he is well, and all who trust in him will have their tears wiped away. Let's pray together. Gracious Father in heaven, we praise you for the glory of our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. We praise you for his resurrection power. We praise you for his victory over sin and death. We praise you for his gentleness and his tenderness toward us. Lord, as we face the days ahead without Dad, without Opa, Grandpa, without Harry, as we adjust to the loss of a dear father, grandfather, brother, uncle, and friend, we pray that you'd fill us with confidence in the victory of our Redeemer Jesus. For we pray this in his name. Amen. We're going to sing together another song that Harry chose for us to sing. We'll stand as we sing, "Great is Thy Faithfulness." After our closing hymn, the funeral director will come forward and they will carry the urn out ahead of us, and then we as a family will follow in behind through these doors, and those of you who are with us as well can follow out those doors. If you would like to join us at the cemetery, you certainly may. You can join the lineup and follow us out to the cemetery. But if you can't join us for that, again, just a word of thanks on behalf of the family for being here to offer your support. Beloved family and friends of Harry Triemstra, receive the blessing of God. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you, and may he give you his peace. And together we say, Amen. Closing him is when peace like a river.